I'm Niklas from Alexander Institute, and where I'm working with machine learning. And I want to talk today a little bit about explainable AI, and maybe you've heard of it, maybe you don't, but I want to try to bring down a bit the hype about explainable AI today as well. Why should you use explainable AI? I will give a little bit of motivation from different directions. So you probably have heard of GDPR, and there are certain parts of the GDPR which might relate to explainable AI. For example, this meaningful information about the logic of a system, or of a system based on artificial intelligence. There's also another part that says you should ensure that there are suitable measures of safeguard to protect the subject of the decision-making system. And I don't want to go into argumentation or discussion about when those rules apply or if they should apply, but you can think of explainable AI maybe as a part of the solution to some of those issues. And I will go a bit further later in the talk to, is it actually explainable AI which solves those problems, or is it something else? Something I don't have on the slides, but what I just read in the train this morning is the white paper from the EU Commission about artificial intelligence. And there they're also proposing some regulatory framework of AI systems. And there's also a lot of talk about discrimination and transparency, which also is related to explainable AI in some way. Some other way you could use explainable AI is to verify that your model actually does something reasonable. So as you might know, in machine learning, you only learn correlations which are existent in the data. The models usually don't learn some kind of causality or try to find some logic. And depending on your data, that can lead to very interesting correlations if I want to formulate it like this. So, for example, in this model has learned to, when it should detect boats, then it looks at water in the image, but not at the boat. And the same model has also learned that to recognize horses in an image, it has to look at the watermark in the image, because in this specific data set, there's so watermarks are more frequent on horse images than any other image in the data set. So that's the model just has learned, okay, there's some frequent correlation of that, so that's how I recognize horses. And that's of course not what you want, because if you have an image without a watermark, then it would say there's no horse in the image. Or if you have boats lying in the desert, or maybe on some car trailer or something, then it wouldn't recognize boats. And maybe in this case, it's not so critical that the model makes mistakes, but it's still interesting to understand what the model actually has learned and how it makes the decisions. A more critical case is when we look at medicine, and this is a very classical example from 2015, where they looked into a model which is predicting the likelihood of being severely ill on pneumonia and maybe even die of it. And the model has learned that when someone has asthma, they have a lower risk of dying of pneumonia. And this is, of course, not really the truth. The reason it has learned that is because people who had asthma in the data set had better medical treatment to begin with, which meant that they were less likely to die or less likely to be severely ill because they had better medical treatment. But that's not the application world you would deploy this model in. So in this case, maybe you shouldn't use that model to predict if someone would die of pneumonia. So that has a little bit of motivation. What actually is explainable AI, and how can we do it? So one thing to notice is that explainable AI is not only something from the computer science world, because in the end, explanations will be used by someone who might not be a computer scientist. So it's very important to remember that it shouldn't only come from the computer science community, because otherwise we end up of inmates running the asylum. So we end up with generating explanations from computer scientists for computer scientists, but not for the ones the explanations should actually be used to or for. So that's why it's actually quite a cross-disciplinary field of computer science, human-computer interaction, because you also have to design some kind of interface to present the explanations, and social science, philosophy and psychology to understand how humans make decisions, how humans make errors when making decisions. We had some examples in the talk just before. And all of that together kind of forms the field of explainable AI. What is explainable AI? So it is about explaining something, and it's about explaining the machine learning model or the AI we have trained. Usually you separate in two different ways of explaining. You can do kind of a global explanation where you try to explain the whole logic of the model, or you can do a local explanation where you try to explain a specific decision made by the model instead of the whole logic. And just to show you an example how you also can understand explainable AI in a more like general setting, it can also be that about understanding where in the pipeline of the whole system explanations are needed and what type of explanations. It might not be that it has to be technical explanations explaining the model. It can also be explanations about what data have I used to train the model, what was the process of training, and so on. So, what is the goal of explainable AI? Well, I mean, since most of the methods developed actually come from data scientists, they are used by data scientists. And in this case, they are mainly used to have a better idea of why does my model fail, or why does it work good, to improve it, and to find a little bit out about the strengths and the limits of the model. And actually, there was a recent study from this year where they asked people from different companies, so not only data scientists, how they use explainable AI. So if they use explainable AI, and if so, how do they use it in their business? And they actually found out that predominantly it's actually used for that kind of purpose. So it's actually mostly used for some kind of quality assurance or debugging. So what I can say for now, explainable AI is in 90% of the cases used for quality assurance or debugging. But what actually people had in mind when they came up with explainable AI is to use it for the end users of the system. To create trust and to help in the decision-making process. One thing which also comes from psychology is that people mostly have need for explanations if some result is kind of against their own opinion. That's when usually people want explanations. And then there might also be some stakeholders interested in some ethical or legal questions where explainability can help of getting a bit more insight into that. Some other kind of unrelated usage of explainable AI can be verification, as I've shown before. It can also be that you want some additional information, not just the outcome of the machine learning model, but that the outcome of the model is part of a decision process with many other factors, so any additional information might help to make a better decision. Can we use explanations to fix wrong decisions made by humans or biased decisions made by humans? And then there are other use cases where the result of some machine learning model might be needed to explain further. So for example, if there's some model used by a doctor to find out which diagnose to give or which treatment to give to patients, they usually need to explain why they make this decision. And there it might be possible that you need more information than the output of the model. Another thing could be simplifications of the model. So it could be that you train a deep neural network to predict anything, but then with help of Explainable AI actually find out that it only looks at a handful of factors. So can you not just make a simpler model which only uses this handful of factors instead of 1,000 different variables? How to create Explainable AI? Well, there is a lot of different methods. And this is just the ones which IBM developed, and they put them all in this tree. And you can put a lot of more methods on that tree and also expand the tree in different directions. So it's actually very difficult to say what method to use in which context, because there are so many and they all have different purposes. So if we start in the very top, the first thing to divide between is kind of a static or interactive explanation. Interactive explanation, that would be something we heard in the previous talk, in form of a kind of a chatbot where you can ask further questions once you get an explanation. Actually, as far as I know, there's no method who does that now. So all of them are kind of static, they generate one explanation and that's it, you don't get more information than that. Then another way to divide it is, are we explaining the model or are we explaining the data? When we explain the model, I already talked about the difference between local and global explanations. Then there's something called post-hoc or self-explaining. That means, is the model we trained capable of explaining itself, or is it a method we kind of use in addition with the model? And then there's also the type of explanation, and I will very briefly go through the different types, because there's not so much time to explain all the theory behind it, but one way is rules. So you make a bunch of rules, and then when you make a decision, you can just go back and see which rules were used, and by that have some explanation what the model used. And the same way of representing rules can also be in form of binary rules in a tree. Then you can look at examples in the training data. So this is actually a model to evaluate kind of your training data, where it's about finding the most representative data points in your data set and then find those points which are most or furthest away from those prototypes but still in the same set. So maybe I should go to the other side. So in this case it's about images of golden retrievers, and it finds the most representative images of golden retrievers and then those which are still labeled golden retrievers in the data but maybe look a bit different because they have some costumes on, or it's like a group of golden retrievers. And this method can help you understand where kind of the boundaries of my data. So in this case, when we train a model to detect golden retrievers based on this data, we can be sure that it also detects golden retrievers with bunny ears, for example. So that's something good. Then we can also look in, when we do a prediction, what were actually the images in the training data which were most relevant for making the prediction. And here we have two different models. Now I have to go to the other side again. So one model, when predicting that this is a clownfish, actually looked at those images, and the other model looked at these images. And then we can say that actually this model has not learned how a clownfish looks like, it just has learned how something orange and white look like. So that's maybe not the best model to use to detect clownfish, because it will also say that this is a clownfish, for example. Then when we talk about deep neural networks, we know that they learn some kind of abstract representation of the data, and that you can also visualize. So this is some visualizations of different depth within the neural network, and you can see as the closer you get to the output, the more abstract is kind of the idea of what the neural network thinks about this image. So in this case, it says that in this corner, there's something that looks like a lemon. Here we have a vase, and here we have something that looks like flowers. And that can also help to understand kind of how the model thinks in an abstract way. And then this is just another example of how to show kind of how much a specific variable, how much impact that has on the output of the model. And the most common or most popular method, I would say right now, which is also related to that they have a lot of good implementations of those type of method, is called feature attribution, where it's about saying which variable was most responsible for generating a specific output. And that you can of course do with images, where it's then about pixels in the image. You can do it with text, where it's about which word in the text was most relevant for making a specific decision. Some examples of how you could use explanations in an application, and these are research applications, so actually nothing which is actually used in industry, but might be used in industry or could be used in industry. So here's an example of some kind of dashboard of a diagnosis system for doctors, where the system says, okay, what are the possible diagnoses, but then also explains kind of which health features it looked like to make that decision. And then also some examples of what should you change, or what should change to get a different decision. Another way you could use explanations is as a learning tool. So you train the model which can classify birds, but also knows what it looks in the image for classify specific birds. And then you can make some kind of learning system where you teach people how to classify birds. And then when they make a wrong decision, the model can tell them, oh, maybe you should look at this area next time to figure out that this is an alpha bird or this is a bravo bird. So in this way, you can kind of implement explanations in your system to use it as a learning tool. So since we're in the data ethics section, we should ask the question, is explainable AI actually the answer to our ethical questions or to generate meaningful information about the logic? And my answer to that is no. Very short. So most of the time it's used actually for verification or debugging. And yes, it could be used for meaningful information, but most of the explanations which can be generated nowadays require some technical understanding. So they cannot just be given to some end user of the system and they would know what to do with it. So it's just not as simple as that. And we actually went to the stage that we say, when we talk about explanations, we don't only mean technical explanations, but also kind of more general explanations of the process of how we develop the model, what data we use to train the model. So it's actually about explanations about the process and involving all the stakeholders in the process of designing the model, which creates trust and answers to ethical questions. Yeah, that was it.